statistics. So, as you know, statistics you are coming across in day-to-day life. How you are coming across statistics? Suppose you want to study. Suppose you want to study during your exam hours, and your parents say that you have to study for at least 4 hours in a day. Right? Now, you are not a very studious guy. So, you want to generate a claim against their wish. And you don't want to study for 4 hours. What will you do? It's day-to-day practice. So, you will go to your friends. You will ask a friend, how many hours do you study in a day? One person says 4. One person says 6. One person says, I study only for 2 hours. Another person says, no, I study for 5 hours. One person says, I will study for 10 hours. Some other person says, I study for 1 hour. Now you have a data. This is the data. This is the data available to you. You actually went to 6 students and asked them, how many hours do you study for? Right? So, this is the data. Now, what will you do with this data? Must have done this. So either you will add this data set 4 plus 6 plus 2 plus 5 plus 10 plus 1. Okay. Then what will you do with this? So it's let us total it 4 plus 6 10 10 plus 2 12 12 plus 5 17 17 plus 1 18 and it is 28. Right. And you have taken observations 1 2 3. We have already seen it 6. So 4, 5, and 6. So naturally you do 28 by 6. Then what will it come? 6, 4, 7. 6, 6, 5 are 30. 6, 4 is 24. 4 remaining. 6, 5 are 30. 6, 6 are 36. 6, 6 are 36, and so on. Right? So it's 4.66. Now, you cannot argue with your parents that you should study for more than 4 hours every day, because the data that you have collected actually comes out to be that every student is studying for 4.66 hours. Okay. So, when you study statistics, you will call this as mean of the data. Right. So, say just a demonstration, I am not defining mean in a rigorous manner. Another way, you are still not happy. Okay. So you will find another ways. I will arrange this data. How will you arrange? What is the least value? 1. What is the next least? 2. The next least is 4. The another one is 6. Another one is 5. Then 6. Then 4, 5, 6, 10. Now you will say, oh, okay. So what is the middle value of this data? So 1, 2, 3, since I have a data of 6 elements, I will take 4 and 5, and I will take 4 plus 5 by 2, which is equal to 9 plus 2, so 4, 9 divided by 2, so 4.5. Still you are getting that you should study for more than 4.5 hours. So this kind of calculation is done by median. This is called median of the data. This is the data, which is in ordered form. Even if you order it in another way, like you start from 10 to go to 1, it is 4.5. Another thing that you want to see is if there is any repetition that many people are studying in a similar manner. Like suppose if there is one data point, say 5, I introduce a data point 5, then there are 2 people who are studying for 5 hours in this data set. If I look at, there are 2 people studying for 5 hours. So this is 5 is the number which is repeated most of the times. So this particular thing is called mode of the data. 5. So in this case, you cannot argue with your parents that you should study for less than 4 hours during exam time. So this is how we try to justify our claims when we study statistics. So this gives you a brief idea of what we are doing in statistics. Only these measures are not enough, but we will devise some more measures to study statistics in detail. So let us, this was a motivating example. Let us come to the actual term statistics. What does statistics mean? Statistics. So this statistics term is used in two ways. One, it is a discipline in which you study data. So statistics is a discipline in which you study data. Another thing is, it's just a list of data values which you may use to infer or not. It depends on you. So it's just a list of data values. So suppose I say I want a book on educational statistics. Want a book on educational statistics in India. What does it mean? It means there is some book which exists which will list all the data values which may not infer something about the data, right? So it just gives you the list. So in UP there are X number of institutes, in Maharashtra there are Y number of institutes, in Maharashtra there are Y number of institutes, in Gujarat there are Z number of institutes. It just gives you this data. It doesn't tell anything about the data, the goodness or badness of data. Whereas if I make a statement that I study statistics, of stock data, to get better results, for my investments. What does this statement mean? So I study statistics of stock data to get better results for my investment. This statement means I actually collect the data, I analyze the data, and when I analyze the data, I get something which I use, I get some statistic which I use to change my investments or to optimize my investments, right? So this is when statistics is used as a discipline in which you study data. This is just recording of the data, educationals. I want a book on educational statistics in India, where you will not predict anything. These days in Times of India or any newspaper, you get the air pollution count, right? Air pollution count. So they specify something like today it was moderate, today air pollution was moderate, or it was healthy, or it was worst. I'm not getting the exact terminology, but this is how they classify the data, right? So sometimes in Delhi it is worst, in generally in Chennai it is moderate, and there is nothing which is healthy in any of the cities in which they give the count. So in that case, if you get consistent data about this, you can try to infer something about the city's health. So all these things are nothing but examples of statistics. So statistics actually can be divided into two parts. One is a discipline in which you study data, and another one is list of data values. Now, if you look at the definition of statistics, one word is common, that is data. Here also we have used the word data. What does this data mean? There are many things that are coming these days. Is data analysis, big data. So what does this data mean? If you look at the scientific word, if you look at the dictionary meaning of data, it's nothing but plural of the word datum. And this datum means piece of information. So datum is nothing but piece of information. what is data? It's a plural of this. That means it's many pieces of information. So there are several pieces of information which you will try to put it together. When you try to put it together in a meaningful way, you will get statistics. Okay. Statistics is nothing but a processed information from which you can make some sense out of data. So this is statistics. Now that we have understood the meaning of the word statistics, that is a processed information which comes out of data. Also, statistics is a discipline in which you study data, or otherwise it's list of data values. Now let us try to study statistics. So anything that you study in statistics has to deal with data. So let us start with our first topic, that is collection of data. So how will you collect data? There are two ways in which you can collect the data. One is primary, another one is secondary. Let us see what is primary collection of data. Let us see what does primary collection of data mean. Primary is you, when you want to collect the data, you will actually go to each and every subject and collect the data. For example, when I gave this example, you actually went to each of your friends and collected the values 4, 6, 2, 5, 10, 1. Right? So this is the source of primary data. So this is primary data. You actually do the survey. What is secondary data? Instead, you go on internet, you see how many hours kids study of your age, and you collect the data and try to refute the claim of your parents. That is a secondary data. So it is something like you have not actually done the survey, but you have collected the data from the people who have already done the survey. That is secondary data, and this is primary data. Secondary data may contain some processed data, so it may contain some statistics, which is a processed data of the primary data. So now let us try to see how the primary data is obtained or how the secondary data is obtained. So let us take one example. Suppose we want to conduct a survey. Will you do? You can do it in two ways. Your school database may have a data set which has already recorded the heights of the students, or you can go to each and every candidate and try to figure out what is the height of that particular person. So these are the two ways in which you can consider the heights of the students. Right. So suppose if you want to conduct a survey and you are conducting the heights of the students in say centimeters, so it may be 120 centimeters, 125 centimeters, 130 centimeters, 170 centimeters, it becomes too tall, so 140 centimeters, 150 centimeters. For the sake of brevity, we will keep it short. So I have taken heights of 6 students, and now I want to represent this data. So how will I represent this data? So we have collected the data and you have actually seen the data set at the primary level, so it's a primary data collection. Right. Now I want to represent this data. How will I represent this data? Or I want to see some salient features of this data. So first, as it is given, I cannot create any sense out of it. So what I will do is, I will just rearrange the data set. What is the least value in this? It's 120. Then it is 125. Then it is 130. Then it is 140. 150. 170. Okay, so this is the rearranged data. So I have processed this data now. Now, if I ask a question, in what range the heights of the student vary? So I am asking a question, what is the range of the data set? What should be the range? It should be, so what is the least value? It's 120. It's 170 is the highest value. So 170 minus 120 should be the range. So it is 50 centimeters. So the student's height varies in 50 centimeters. This is the new information that is given to me out of the data. So this is called statistic. So this is statistic of range. So statistics is a plural. So I will remove this S, which will be statistics. This is a statistic of range. So I hope I made myself clear. Now I want to represent this data. So, but this is a small data set, so I need a larger data set. Let us say I will consider the marks obtained. Just see this problem. Consider the marks obtained by 30 students out of 100 marks. These students are of class 11. So these are the marks obtained. Now this data is difficult to summarize. Or this data if we want to reorder, you have to take some efforts. So instead of this, what we can do is we can actually try to tabulate the data. How will we tabulate the data? We will just see if I order this data set, how many marks are repeated. So let us try to tabulate the data using marks and the number of times the marks are repeated. That means the number of students. This number is called frequency. The number of times the event happens, this is frequency. So first I see the marks are 10. Let us put 10 here. And the number of students with 10 marks is 1. Students with marks 1 is 1. Now let us take 20. This is the second term. 20. One person is there with 20 marks. Nobody else is there with 20 marks.
2:30. That's what you have to check.
So 5 5 plus 4 9 9 plus 3 12 12 plus 4 14 14 plus 8 22 23 24 24 26 plus 4 30. Yes, this entire thing sums up to 30.
And now you check the difference between these two representations. This representation is representation of a raw data. This representation is representation of a data which is written in a more disciplined manner. So this is called ungrouped. Frequency distribution table. This is very important because it gives you very quick snapshot of the data. If you want to be more precise, you can just draw this table. Okay, sorry. Just draw this table. This gives you a very quick snapshot of the data, and such a table is called ungrouped frequency distribution table, or simply frequency distribution table. This word is suppressed. Why ungrouped? Because here I am using only one number. Again, make it a grouped distribution table, but it's okay. So now, but this is a sample of 30 students. It can go further. It can be a sample of 100 students. It can be a sample of 200 students. In this case, the representation that is given here, this is a raw data, is not very helpful. In that case, you have to go for the distribution of this kind. Right? So, that is why this is a good representation of a data set. Now, this also can be done using the tally marks, which you might have seen earlier. Now, if you have been given a distribution of 100 plants. So suppose 100 plants are planted. In your school. And such a procedure is done for 100 schools. 100 plants are planted in 100 schools. And after few months, you are doing a survey, and after few months you notice that the number of plants that survived are and then you will have a raw data of 100 data points. So let me paste that data. Now, because I have been given 100 data points, I cannot go and write all the 100 points. So, I have to do an intelligent choice. So, what I will do is, I will just tabulate this data as number of plants survived. And their frequency. But to count the 100 points, I need one measure, which is called tally marks, which you might have seen. And then the frequency. Let me abbreviate it. So, as I mentioned, I will not know what is the height of each and every plant. If I try to record the height of each and every plant, I can go as many as more than 50 rows. I don't want to do that. So, what I will do is, I will see the least height. What is the least height in this? It's 20. Okay. So I will start with 20. I will create a bin. I will create a class of 10 data points. So 20 to 29. Then I will create from 30 to 39. 40 to 49. is the maximum height. That's what we have to see now. How far I can go? I can see the number 83. Can I see the number which is greater than 90? Yes, I can. So I will go up to 99. So 50 to 59, 60 to 69, 70 to 79. 90 to 99. Now you see. Now I want to figure out all those numbers which are less than 20 to 29. Here is a number 28. I will put one tally mark here. 7, 2. So I will put another tally mark. Then there is a number 23 here also. I put another tally mark. Is there any number which is less than 30? No. So this gives me the frequency of 3. Similarly, you can do this and you can see from 30 to 39 I have 14 points. Similarly, you can complete this table. It has 40 to 49, it has 12, and then it has 50 to 59, it has 8, 18, 60 to 69, 70 to 79, it has 10, and, 80 to 89, it has 23, then it has 12. So you can finish this tally marks table, and now the total should be 100. That is our cross check. So just check it, you will get the number to be 100. So this is the total. This completes our table of frequency. Now what we have seen here is, here we are actually not dividing the table into one class value. We are actually splitting it into, say for example, all the numbers that are between 20 to 29 are in one class. Whereas when I did this table, all the numbers are not in one class. They are individual numbers. Okay. And that is why we call this as ungrouped frequency table. Then what should be the name of this? It should be a grouped frequency table. Or simply frequency table if you are not interested in having group name. Okay. Now, here are some interesting observations. Suppose I want to ask a question, for how many schools more than 50% of the plants survived? How will you answer that question? Just look at this 50 to 59, and beyond that, all the plants that are survived are having, so basically beyond that, all the plants that are survived are greater than or equal to 50, right? So you can just sum total this. If you sum total this, you will get 71 as the tally. So now you can easily see that 71 schools, more than 50% of the plants have survived. Interesting observation. So now we are actually trying to do some, we are actually trying to make some conclusions about the data. 71 schools have more than 50% of the plants survived. further split this table. If you want more distinction between the schools, you can further split this table from 20 to 25 and 26 to 29, and you can again rewrite this table. That will be more time consuming, but you can do that if you want the final distribution of the data sets. This is one way. Now, all these plants and all are the data that was considered in integers. Now suppose you have been given another data set where you have been given weights in kgs. Kgs are given to you. Now you want to compute it. You want to compute the data. Let us now not get the raw data. Let us get the actual table. Let us get the table. Somebody has done the work for us and they have given us the table. So the table is weights in kgs. The way we did here, we will continue to do here, and the number of students. Now, the weights in kgs are something like this. 31 to 35. Okay. This is the weight. It's 9. 36 to 40, it is 5. Then 41 to 45, the weight is 14. The number of students is 14. Then 46 to 50, the number of students are 3. Then 51 to 55. Of students is 1. 56 to 60. The number of students are 2. 61 to 65. The number of students is 2. Then 66 to 70. Students is 1, and the last one is 71 to 75. The number of students is 1. So I got the weights of around 38 students. Right. But now, if some new data comes, and the person's weight is say 35.5. This is the new data that has arrived. Now, according to this scheme, where will I put that weight? So, it's a problem. Or else, for that matter, let it be say some 45.5 kgs. Where will I put that weight? So, if I put it 35.5, I cannot put it in the bin of 36 to 40. I cannot put it in the weight 31 to 35. So here is a problem. So I need to modify something about the data. Right. So what should I do? So the easiest variation that I can do is I can modify the class sizes to accommodate these weights. How will I modify these class sizes? Now, because I am considering all the numbers are in integers, I am having this problem. That means essentially I am considering a discrete data set. But the data that I am getting is not discrete. It's a continuous data set. Then I am getting the numbers which are in between. If I have a discrete data, then there is no problem with this division of 1. But now because I have a continuous data, I have to accommodate this data by making some substitute arrangement. So let us try to see 31 to 35 is the data set. The next successive column is 36 to 40. How can I accommodate the weight of 35.5 into one of these? So what I can do is, I will just see the upper limit of this class is 36. That means the lower limit of this class and the upper limit of this class is 35.
So if I can do something like 35 by 36 upon 2, I will get a final division of 35.5. Now, this, what I can do is I can do for every successive class. That means I can split the class of 31 to 30.5 to 35.5. But this should not alter the class width of other classes. What is the class width? It's like the difference between the upper bound and the lower bound. So let me define the class width for you. Upper value of the class width. Let me write it properly. So for me, the class width is value of the class minus lower value of the class. So for example, if I consider the class of 31 to 35, then this is the class that I am considering, then the class width will be 35 minus 31, which is equal to 4. This is the class width for me. Similarly, if I take the another class, which is 36 to 40, then it is 36 minus, its upper bound is 40. So 40 minus 36, which is again going to be equal to 4. And you check for all others, it will be, the class width will be 4. Now, if I change my class width to this, then I should do this uniformly for all other classes. Now you look at this, it's 35.5 minus 30.5. That means I am changing my class width to be equal to 5. So this class width equal to 5, the change should be reflected in all other classes. So how will you do that? You will just change the class 31 to 35. This should be changed to 30.5 to 35.5. Similarly, 36 to 40 should be changed to 35.5 to 40.5. Then next class was 41 to 45, which will be changed to 40.5 minus of to 45.5. Now all these will have a class range of class width of 5.5, and you reflect the changes in this, and then you can accommodate all these data sets. So let me write this data set again with these two additions. That is, I have added the two points. One with the value, one had a value of 35.5, and the other one had a value of 40.5. So let me accommodate this. So with this new modification, we can rewrite this as to 35.5
be included in this class. So I will replace this number by 6 and the entry 45.5. Entry 45.5 will again be included in this particular zone, which is the fourth zone. So this number, this entry will become 2. Is the first, 40.5 is this, 45.5 is 14. Okay, so 45.5 to 50. So this is the fourth cell. So this is this, and therefore it will be 3 plus 1 is equal to 4. Now the tally will change to 40. So this is how we accommodated the entry, which was not earlier possible because of the discrete assumption. But now we make the data to be continuous. Now you give me any number in this range, I can accommodate that number. So this is the small change that we have made, and we have made the collection to be a continuous collection. Now let us come to another topic. So we have represented the data in the tabular form. Now what about the more elaborate description of the data in the graphical form? So let us now come to another topic, which is graphical representation of the data. So here we have many options. So first one is bar graph. Bar graph or bar diagram, this is called bar graph or bar diagram, is preferred when you don't have any numbers associated with your data. For example, let us take one example. The amount of rainfall centimeters. Now, the amount of rainfall, let us not worry about the unit, in Chennai. Now, this is the data that is given to you. And then they are saying in January some amount of rainfall happened. So let us say 4 centimeters. Or then in February another 10 did happen, March 15, April some 4 again, May somewhere around 5 happened. So basically every month Chennai has rainfall. This is the ideal situation. Now this is the data available to me. I want to compare the data set. So I want to actually see it graphically and compare it. Now if you look at the data on x-axis, let us put this, this is the month and this is amount of rainfall. Now if you look at this, you don't really need any x-axis scaling. What you need is just an indicator that this is a month of Jan, and you need something like this. So here the range is 15. So let me put maximum possible rainfall is 15. the month of January, 4 is the rainfall. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is 15, I think. So let us see, 4 is the rainfall. So I will just tag this here. I will draw a bar over here. This is the amount of rainfall in January. Let us go further and put it here. So this is the month of February. In the month of February, the rainfall was 10. Just come here. I will put a bar across this line. This is the line of 10. Similarly, in the month of March, which is here, March, the rainfall was 15. Now I will just raise a line. Just need to put a line here. April. The rainfall is 4. That's what I want to denote. It's this way. Similarly, May, June, July. I have to draw. So, May it is 5. May it will be somewhere here. This is the month of May. June. It is 3. So, it will be somewhere here. July it is 2, that is the least, so it will be somewhere here. This is June, this is July. So this kind of representation, I can denote it this way. This kind of representation is called bar diagram or bar chart. This is helpful. When you have your data set, actually this is the data that you want to split on, so it's not a number. For example, the data set can be how many people speak different languages. So somebody may say English, Spanish, Chinese, Tamil, Marathi, Hindi, all these languages can be considered, and you can actually draw a bar chart for each of the languages. So in such cases, your bar chart is helpful. So this is months, is the x-axis, and this y-axis is nothing but the rainfall in appropriate centimeters, centimeter square, whatever the unit. Right. Now, from this bar chart, what you can see, what is more visible, those who are visual readers, it is more visible that in the month of March, we had more rainfall, right, throughout. And in the months of Jan, April, May, we had occasional rainfalls. And in the month of July, we had the least rainfall. So this kind of representation, which is not very clear from this data, the tabular data, is more clear when you actually graphically represent the data. That is why graphical representation is somewhat helpful. So this is how you represent using bar diagram. Class we will see what do we mean by histogram, or when the x-axis is numerical data values.